Well, it's good to see you. You have made your way to the online service for November 1st, 2020. Along with this online service, we're having an on-site service at New Hope today at 10 o'clock. By the way, if you think you're coming to that service, make sure you double check your clock because it's daylight savings change of November 1st, and you fall back. So don't forget that. Also, if you come to church, I think Shoemaker and Jarnigan's class is not going to be having Sunday school today. I think some things might slow down as a result of the upswing in COVID now, but nothing definitive to say on that yet. But their class won't be meeting. Just a few announcements, things to have on your calendar. I'll mention them briefly, and then you can try to run them down later in subsequent church emails. But Saturday, November the 7th, that's this Saturday, at Billy and Kelsey Crosby's place, New Hope children and their families are invited to a bonfire from 5 to 7. Saturday morning, November 15th, Jacob Jones got in touch with me and asked us to have some people who would be part of a Zoom prayer gathering on behalf of TCM. More details coming soon on that. Sunday, November 15th is the Polar Express Party for Kids. That is a Sunday evening, 4:30 to 7, and it's a pajama party, and the teenage youth group is going to help lead the kids through that. That's all kids out of diapers through the sixth grade, and then teenagers will be assisting with that event. November 18th is a congregational quarterly meeting in the venue, 6:30. And then don't forget that during this Christmas holiday season, we are collecting tomatoes money for tomato soup for Love Chapel. They're asking for money this year just to prevent so much handling of the product. So Love Chapel's providing meals for families, and we're providing the tomato soup for those meals. You might also mark on your calendar that we're in charge of the community meal on December the 8th. I think that's at Memorial Baptist. More information on that soon. Just a couple of words about the online worship service. I continue working through the New Testament letter, 1 Thessalonians. Last week, on Sunday morning, I forgot to hit the record button on the camera, and so I didn't get the music and communion recorded from the last Sunday service, so we're doing some repeats on here now. What about the Rona? We've had a sort of an uptick in that with quite a few people that I personally know being affected by it, some of them dealing with serious cases of it. And so I do attach at the end of this some information from Brad York, who is our congregational COVID advisor. Brad is a nurse practitioner, cardiology specialist, at Columbus Regional Hospital and with Southern Indiana Heart and Vascular Group, but he provides some helpful information, and he is available for you if you have any questions about the Rona or worried about some symptoms you might think you have or whatever, need to know what to do next. He'll help you with that. So take that in if you haven't already listened to it. I hope you enjoy. I hope we all at some point get together soon. God bless.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Let the one who is wise heed these things and ponder the loving deeds of the Lord.
My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you with my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with glory, Lord of light, I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, I will praise you, Lord.
I've entitled this sermon, Embodied Good News, and hopefully it will become clear why I did that. And I base what I have to say today on 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'll use verses 1 through 12. Paul writes, "You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain, but though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated in Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God, who tests our hearts. As you know, and as our God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day so that we might not burden any of you while we proclaimed to you the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory." There is a famous hiker slogan that you'll sometimes see posted at a trailhead that says, "Leave nothing but footprints, kill nothing but time, take nothing but pictures." In other words, respect the world that you now enter. Treat it carefully. Don't unnecessarily disturb its inhabitants. Be gentle with the land. You've probably been places where the gentle approach is violated. I've hiked miles up a stream in a national forest only to come across beer cans and plastic soda bottles, empty fast food sacks, discarded clothes, diapers, toilet paper, and, shall we say, other evidence of human presence. Someone was an ugly guest. I start with that because I think Paul's missionary journeys sometimes come across to us as though he was an ugly guest as he worked his way around the Mediterranean world. He enters these strange cities, we think, without much regard for the culture or the people. He stirs things up and then leaves in a cloud of dust. He has a message to share, hell or high water, and he'll say it no matter who it offends. If that's your view of Paul, that he is a careless hiker, I think this second chapter of 1 Thessalonians is a good corrective. Read it carefully. He is the gentler hiker. Plus, and I'll talk about this more at the end of the sermon, I think that what we hear from Paul in this chapter should inform the way that we, as followers of Jesus and missionaries of sorts like him, go about our business today. Let me highlight how Paul seems to characterize his ministry with just a handful of themes. I would start with the word courage. Paul speaks of how boldly he and his co-workers proclaimed the good news of God in spite of great opposition. So, to use the hiking analogy, there is no doubt that Paul went to Thessalonica intending to leave behind some footprints. He was determined to go into these urban centers around the Mediterranean Sea and rather conspicuously share a message that he believed was good for people, and sometimes in the process people got upset. No doubt about that. I wouldn't deny that at all. He was capable, you might say, of making some noise when he was in the forest. Sometimes he stirred the pot so much that the locals tried to make him dead. That had happened right before he visited Thessalonica when he was in Philippi, which was just about 75 miles to the north of Thessalonica. Acts 16 tells how Paul and his friends encountered there in Thessalonica a slave girl whose masters were making money off of her fortune-telling skills. That situation annoyed Paul, who then cast the spirit of divination out of her. That infuriated her owners, who saw it as a drain on their income. So the girl's owners had Paul and his friend Silas dragged into town, the town center, where the magistrates ordered them to be beaten with rods. When they arrived in Thessalonica, the marks of that experience were no doubt still fresh upon them. So it's true that Paul often did leave a little more than a footprint when he went somewhere. But cities are not forests, are they? Cities are not nature. They are diverse marketplaces of ideas. And Paul had some ideas that he thought needed to be added to the conversation. Ideas from God. Ideas, for instance, that would say no to men exploiting slave girls. Paul was confident that his good news was superior to the kind of news that people were living by in Thessalonica. And he was courageous enough to share it, even knowing that it would probably cost him something. But now, please get past whatever kind of disturbance he happened to cause there, in order to see that he did his work, he worked rather hard at being gentle and not causing unnecessary chaos. The rest of the verses in our reading today lay out in detail how carefully he tried to go about his business of sharing the good news of Jesus. Now, next, I will use the word integrity and the phrase not for personal gain. Paul goes to great lengths to remind the newly founded church in Thessalonica that they were not, for him, a money-making scheme. He was careful not to take advantage of them. In the ancient world, as in the modern world, there's no shortage of con artists and swindlers looking to make some easy money. Even philosophers liked to go to towns and introduce their promising new idea to the people, and then take payment for next level initiation. You've got to pay to play, baby. Even philosophers went about it like that. But Paul reminds his friends in Thessalonica that he did not operate that way. And there's something here in the text that suggests, to me at least, that he is telling the truth. Three times in this section, he uses the phrase, as you know, which when you write that into a letter, puts the truth of what is being said entirely in the court of the reader. If there is someone in the audience who can say, wait, I don't know that. You say, as you know, but I don't know that. And that's not at all how I remember that. If there's even one person that can say that, then the argument starts to fall apart. It wouldn't take much at all to discredit what Paul says if the information for discrediting him is available. And yet, what's interesting, think about this, the letter gets saved and it gets passed between churches and becomes part of the early record of Jesus and the church. So you have to think that how Paul represents his ministry is how it really was. And there was nothing in it for his own gain, is what he says. I want to add in also the word restrained. Paul suggests that he chose not to use all the power that was available to him. A teacher has a right, he says in other letters, to receive fair compensation for his teaching. But he did not want the dynamics of payment to cloud his relationship with the community. And so, in Thessalonica, he supported himself. Plus, he is an apostle, a miraculously called and sent ambassador of Jesus, which should earn him some special respect. Didn't he have a right just to snap his fingers and get that respect? But again, he chooses not to play that card. He chooses to teach from a position of weakness, humbly yet boldly through that weakness. What Paul is himself choosing to do here sort of reminds me of what he says about Jesus in a later letter that he would write, the letter to the church in Philippi, where in chapter 2, he speaks of Christ, who being in very nature God, emptied himself of godly advantages in order to become human, and became at that a servant of humans. Christ did not exert authority over us, but emptied himself, that poem says, on our behalf in sacrificial love. Paul seems to have followed that pattern in his friendship with the folks in Thessalonica. He points out that he did not operate with a heavy hand, but with a servant's heart. And then maybe you noticed in our reading how Paul describes his friendship with the Thessalonians in family terms. First, and think about this, Paul, who is sometimes criticized for being too patriarchal, here compares his work with the Thessalonians to a mother nursing her baby. You won't find a closer, warmer, more nurturing image than that one. And then a few verses later, he becomes the father figure of the congregation. We dealt with you, he says, the way a father deals with his children. And the words that he uses to describe that paternal relationship are not words like correction and discipline, but it's a much softer vocabulary. The father who urges, who encourages, who pleads, not a coercive father operating from the top down, but a gentle guiding presence beside his children. one of the most intriguing lines in this whole section of scripture in chapter 2 is verse 8, where Paul says that he and his co-workers are determined to share not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves. Not just a message, but themselves, their own bodies. Here is the point that I want to make today. It is that the sharing of the good news of God is never just a sharing of information or data or facts. The good news of God is always embodied good news. The gospel is incarnational. The word incarnation means enfleshed. It is enfleshed. It is by nature. The gospel is by nature relayed body to body, which is to say good news that isn't backed by character doesn't make much sense. To be a Christian witness, you can't just say a message and bring it with bad character. It needs to be enfleshed. And isn't that what Paul wants to show here in chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians? That God's good news to Thessalonica isn't this standalone information. It is what he and his co-workers demonstrate bodily in their ministries. Compare that to some other things in life. There are a lot of affiliations that do not necessarily require a particular kind of character. Since we're in the middle of an election cycle, I'll go there. You can be a Republican and be a jerk. That is, you can hold to what are considered to be Republican views, not have a good character at all, and still be considered a Republican because you hold the right views. It might be nice to have the views backed up with good character, but it's certainly not necessary. The message and the character are two different things. And I think vice versa for Democrats. You can have horrible character, but vouch for a Democratic platform and you're still a Democrat. You can be a teacher who hates students, but you're still a teacher. You can be an Aristotelian murderer, but if you favor Aristotle's philosophy, you are still an Aristotelian, even though you're a murderer. We have this way of separating ways of thinking from ways of behaving, ways of being, thinking and being. And I'm arguing that this is all but impossible to do with the Christian faith, because the message is so tied in to the bearer of the message. And that's what Paul's fighting for here, that tied to the message of what he has shared with the Thessalonians through his mouth is this matching message that he shares through his, that he shared through his own presence, his body. Because Christian witness is a matter of sharing one's whole self. That's just the way it works. That's why the gospel is a unique kind of information. When God wanted to make his perfect communication to the world, how did he do it? What kind of a word? A word written on tablets or on scrolls? No, God's ultimate word to the world was the Word made flesh, a message embodied in the person of Jesus. And that's why character and how we present our bodies in this world is such an important matter for the church. The good news is never separate from the bearer of the message. The good news is never separate from character. If you're right in what you say but can't enact it, you're missing the point. So let's speak about Jesus as much in the way that we do things, in the way we present ourselves to those around us, as with what we say. God bless.
I never worry, for why should I worry, though troubles may come my way? I've someone to hide me, to comfort and guide me, to live with me day after day. Never alone, because I know my Lord is with me. Never alone, He's always standing by. Jesus has promised to take my hand and lead me. Never alone, no, never alone am I. Lord, I would serve Thee, would honor and serve Thee in all that I do or say. My heart bows before Thee, I love and adore Thee, I'll live for Thee day after day. Never alone, because I know my Lord is with me. Never alone, He's always standing by. Jesus has promised to take my hand and lead me. Never alone, no, never alone am I.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Those are the rather gut-wrenching words of David after he sinned with Bathsheba, the prayer that's recorded in Psalm 51. I probably sound like a broken record because I mention this a lot, but when we come to the Lord's table, there are so many things going on. There's sacrifice, there is the celebration of community, there is the looking forward, there's eschatology, the looking forward to the world that is to come. That there is fellowship with Jesus, there is all these things. But among these, there is also confession. We shouldn't come to the table without opening our hearts up to the Lord. And our hearts are cracked open to Him. It's whether we want to acknowledge it or not. And so I always think it is appropriate when we come to the table to also treat it as a time of confession. And my favorite prayer of confession is one that I would like for you to recite with me. It's the basic prayer of confession that's in the Book of Common Prayer. This is the modern version. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. How are you doing, Brad?
I'm good. Yourself?
Good. 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 I'll give an introduction to you since I'll send this out to people. But okay. This is Brad York, whom most of you will know. And Brad is a nurse practitioner, specialist in cardiology, who walks the halls of Columbus Regional Hospital quite often, and is with the Southern Indiana Heart and Vascular Group, and is our New Hope expert, closest thing we have to an expert on COVID-19. So, you doing all right?
Yeah, things are good.
Good, good day at work?
Yeah, busy.
Yeah. I was going to just run through a few things. I haven't looked on the local stuff as far as how COVID is doing right now in Bartholomew County. So update me on that, first of all.
Yeah, I think everything is representative to one another right now. Like from a global standpoint, I think things are heightening up a bit.
Right.
Even Indiana, smaller than, I think on average we were, daily was around 400 to 600 new cases a day. Today, actually, I was looking, it was a number one day in a long time. It was 3,500 cases or something around there in one day.
Okay.
So it's a big jump.
Yeah.
And then even smaller locally, it has gone higher as well. I think in the hospital, last couple weeks that I've noticed, been really well controlled, say 3 to 5 patients on average who were sick enough to be hospitalized.
Okay.
Today was like 15.
Oh, really?
And I just I just sent one to the ICU right before I came home.
Okay.
Seems to be as well, whenever we've seen a little bit of like jump in surges, I don't know if that's not a good word to use, but because everything's under control, but before we noticed patterns like families, like if we had a little spike in the hospital, there would probably be families or they had maybe church or something. Like, there was a connection. The thing interesting now is there's a complete dissociation. That gives you a like randomized control trials, you know, that you look for things like that.
Right.
So it's more of a true-ish surge trajectory right now.
Okay. Okay, so widespread. This is the first time that in personally that there have been multiple people that I'm acquainted with in state and out of state, local and not local, who are dealing with it. So we've got some family member up in Wisconsin. Well, several people in their family dealing with it, and then of course in church we've got a few people dealing with it. So you're probably treating some of those, but you can't tell me, or we'll have to revoke you.
Right.
Yeah.
But that is going well. I've gotten some phone calls, and it's worked out well.
Good. Good. Oh, good. From the church. From church.
People. Yeah. Phone call. We've been able to. Mostly, it was like questions on what to do now. What to look for. So we just talk about some basic things. I spend plenty of time, I'll stay on the phone until all questions are answered, and then encourage them to follow up with me too if there's any further questions.
Good.
So,
and it is, people need to know, it is, you have said it is perfectly okay for people to call you to get, yeah, to get next step information.
Yeah, call me anytime. Doesn't matter if it's in the middle of the night. I'm used to being on, used to getting phone calls at night. So, especially if it's something you're truly worried about, definitely give me a call.
Good. Hey, treatment-wise, things have changed a little bit over the 7 months, right? I mean, morbidity seems to be down overall.
Yeah, that's true. We're sending a lot less people to the ICU. They're staying on our COVID unit for some time, just a few days usually.
Okay.
And they're going home very well, in good health. Treatment is kind of interesting. As trials started rolling out, they wanted to, pharmaceutical companies wanted to say, is there anything that we have right now that could help? And one of the first things that got the big buzz was the hydroxychloroquine,
right,
the malaria drug, and it was used a lot. It's dropped out of favor a bit, at least at the hospital here, especially since we enrolled with a Mayo Clinic to give convalescent plasma, okay, which that's an old thing, done that many years, but the premise of it is someone who's been exposed, had COVID, has recovered, we would take a sample of their blood, we have antibodies, we would contain it and then give it through plasma to someone who has COVID to help fight it off. And it seemed like at first may have been helpful, but now I think the trend is people are going home more often than not and in a lot better shape.
Okay.
By the time, other things like remdesivir, it's an antiviral medication.
Right.
The best way to think about it is like the flu. I know it's been compared to the flu a lot, but Tamiflu,
right,
to help reduce symptoms. This is similar. I think on average it can cut down days of symptoms by like 3 days on average. I think some studies have reported.
Okay.
And there's a couple other smaller ones, but that's what we use at the hospital mostly, and people do really well with it. And then steroids is another big thing.
Right.
We give people steroids with it's an inflammatory problem a lot of times.
Right.
So that seems to help too.
Cool. I didn't mean to get too
technical. Until like a vaccine comes out to help with that.
Right. That's good. That's good information. Hey, the best thing we can do is still masks and social distance, right?
Yeah, that's what we found to be helpful, I think. It could save transmitting to someone who may not do well with it.
Yeah.
Like we know high risk population being older people, people who are pregnant or immunocompromised, like they're going through chemotherapy, and you may not know if someone's going through chemo, and if you're not wearing your mask and you have COVID, but you don't know it because you don't have symptoms, which is something that's kind of scary with this. It could be unintentionally transmitted to someone who may suffer the consequences. So I think primary transmission being respiratory, masks seems not foolproof, nothing's foolproof, but it may save someone's life. So I think it's a good thing if you know, people are willing to do it.
Okay. Any other things you want to tell us?
Don't give up hope. This will go away. Yeah. And I think we're doing really well locally, even though there's a little bit of a surge, completely under control. We can have good plans. And I think, as we're getting into the season where it's cooler and people are getting close together, just keep an eye out for one another and try not to get lax with it, but it'll go away. And yeah, we'll be back to a normal before too long. So
I'll hug you soon.
Yes. Looking forward to that. That was the number one thing I missed out on.
All right. That's funny. All right. Well, I really do appreciate you doing this. And I'm aware that a few people have checked in with you. And I think that's good. I do encourage any New Hope people that, especially if they've been around it, or if they feel like they have it, or especially if they find out they have it, contact Brad, because Brad's not going to give you away. But it will be good for the church to know what we're dealing with. And if we need to shut down for a while, that's fine. We'll do whatever we need to do, but it'll be good to stay on top of this. So keep up the good work. We love you and what you're doing. And it's obvious you didn't go into your specialty knowing that within a couple of years of becoming a nurse practitioner, you'd be dealing with this thing, did you?
Yeah, if you had told me that I would have experienced some of the situations I have had experience, I would have told you you're crazy, but learned a lot. And there's a lot of good people I work with who've really helped me along the way. And I think I've helped some people out. So I think that's the point.
I'm sure you have. Well, thanks a lot. And I'll let you get back to your beautiful family.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, John.
Yeah, thanks, Brad.